All right, I am excited because here we are. The U.S. is talking once again to Australia. And Phil, it is great to see you again.
Hey Mark, it's great to be here. Thanks for having me on your show.
No, we really appreciate it. I know we've had great conversations over the past while, and I appreciate our new friendship and things that you've done. And to start it off, why don't we just go there? Why don't you tell everybody who you are, what you do, what you've done? Give us a brief background.
Cool. Okay, so my name is Phil Richards. And I'm a serial entrepreneur. So I have started and created nine different companies. I've exited two for multi-millions already. And my biggest company is a cloud payroll company. So it was New Zealand and Australia's largest cloud payroll company. We process over $2.4 billion per annum of payroll for over 10,000 clients, paying 150,000 people per month. So, that's probably my biggest company that I have currently, and I have a bunch of others, about seven others that I'm working on. So, and I'm a seven times Ironman. I've raced Hawaii Ironman, the World Champs in Kona, and it's Kona week this week, so I'm really excited about that for all the people that are into triathlon. And so that's a quick bit about me. I'm a dad. I've got two children, and happily married. So that's me.
And that's a lot. I love the fact that you're Ironman as well because, as we've talked briefly, I compare sports to business almost all the time on my website and whatnot. And this is an overview of what leadership is in a lot of different ways in this whole series. But when you define leadership, I'm sure you have some comparisons between what you've done as an Ironman and that way as and in your businesses, right?
Oh, totally. Like the biggest thing about sport is it teaches you, the preparation. It teaches you the persistence. It teaches you the whole point about, to win in the race of business. It's very much like Ironman. You just have to stay in the race, because you have ups and downs. Things don't always go your way. And Ironman, which is for me, is a 10-hour race. A lot of people take 17 hours. You have to train and train for years to get there. It's a big, big day, and business is no different. And an Ironman is just a wonderful metaphor for business. And so, as is golf too. I love golf, and the thing about golf is that you can have two really bad shots, do an amazing third shot, and then putt in from 50 feet. And you still make a four, right? So golf is a crazy game for sport too, and it's very, very similar to business. Sometimes in business, you don't know which way it's going to go, but you just have to keep playing, keep hitting that ball, and eventually it'll get in the hole.
Well, it's interesting. Probably get diverse a little bit here, but one of the key things, at least in the U.S., that they always talk about is one of the main reasons small entrepreneurial businesses don't succeed is that they stop.
Exactly, yeah. So, yeah, so I have a little line that I say, which is, I will never, ever, 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 ever give up. And I wear it on my arm, actually, if you look at this. Now, that there
Oh, yeah.
says, never stop. So I will never stop. And I wear that with me wherever I go. And that's my whole sort of attitude towards business, life, and sport.
It's actually brilliant, which I find myself saying a lot more since I've been hanging around some Brits recently. But it's funny. I have a friend who has a 96-year-old father who hikes twice a week, and he hikes and he goes very slow. But he says the key to my success is I never stop. I'm always in motion,
Exactly, yeah.
no matter how fast or slow he's going. This is a pretty good start for. I know we were joking about this for two accountants that absolutely knew early in our life we didn't want to be accountants, huh?
Yeah, sure. Well, I was an ex-Arthur Andersen guy, pre-Enron, but it was a wonderful base too. I learned a lot, and I actually take for granted now how much I learned in those 4 or 5 years I was with Arthur Andersen. So I'm actually very grateful for that background. Really set me up for my entrepreneurial journey.
Well, let me ask you that. You've gone into, interesting enough, you've gone into different types of entrepreneurial ventures, industries, and now even globally. For you, it might be easy, but people are probably wondering, how do you come to be in some of these? How do you even select them, or do they select you? And then how do you select, quote unquote, leaders to grow them?
Cool. Okay, so maybe we'll just start at the beginning there, which is more about me and how I've sort of created this journey. And really, it just comes down to the whole aspect that I love business. So I love helping people, and it's all about, you know, when you find your one thing in life, when you find your why, as Simon Sinek calls it, then everything else just flows. And so I was lucky that at a young age, I found my one thing in life, which was helping people. Mm-hmm. So the first business I fell into was an optometry practice. My wife is an optometrist. Mm-hmm. And so at 26 years old, when I was sick of being an accountant for Arthur Anderson, we decided to buy an optometry practice. And we grew that into a chain of 12 stores, and we sold that to a listed company at 30, and we started our family. So, you know, that one was sort of, we really just bought a job, and then we grew that into a business.
Could you say that you had a vision?
yeah, nice. We had 2020 vision. we were the vision specialists, actually. And, you know, in terms of creating a business that works, you know, I've always been really good at creating that strategic vision, I think. And we did actually end up disrupting that whole optometry space. And so we did a lot of marketing. We did a lot of things. We started the first online contact lens business in New Zealand and Australia. You know, we did a lot of things that were really quite different, but now, you know, they don't look that cool, but, you know, 15 years ago, they were pretty funky.
Yeah, I bet. Well, you know, it's interesting you say that because, you know, a lot of times you, as they say, you don't know what you don't know, and a lot of times you just got to start, right?
Oh, sure. So, you know, and then that led into, you know, my passion for helping business owners, a little bit like what we're doing today. I wanted to figure out a way that I could talk to business owners every single day, but not be a business coach, where I was just selling my time for money. So I created a software product. And at that time, this is 10 years ago, Salesforce.com had just come out and just invented this whole software as a service business, the whole SaaS model, where you just sell software on a subscription. And so we decided to create a payroll company, which is compulsory. You know, I'm basically like the PayPal guy sitting between the business owner and the IRS. And so I just sit in the middle of those two. It's, you know, payroll is never going to go out of fashion. The right. Government always wants its taxes. And so I just sit in there and take my little clip along the way. So that's how we got into that one. And then, you know, from there, it's just blossomed into coming from New Zealand and Australia, they're pretty small countries. You know, the combined population is only half of California. So my eyes started to expand, and I wanted to go do business in the big wide world. And so my next venture was into India, actually. I wanted to choose between China or India, two massive big countries with massive potential. Mm-hmm. And I chose India. And I started making food in India, Indian curries. And I got those manufactured in India and brought them all the way back to New Zealand and Australia and got them distributed throughout all the supermarkets. You know, and I only had to talk to two people, and I got distribution into about 400 or 500 supermarkets, and the business just took off like crazy. So that gives you a bit of a flavor for some of the businesses that I've done.
Well, let me ask you a question. When you're getting into multiple businesses, sometimes it's hard enough for people to run one. How do you determine how much you're actively involved versus getting someone else to lead it? And for example, the India deal, you obviously have to do some research to determine, you know, what to do. How did that come about?
Cool. So I've always had a little saying that I stick by, which is let go to grow. And so I'm never going to grow my business if I'm doing all the work. And I think if we come back to that optometry example where we had these shops, most technicians, like optometrists, for example, they're always busy doing the doing. It's the classic sort of e-myth type stuff, Michael Gerber stuff. And I was the guy that was working on the business. So we were a unique couple. Michelle was doing the medical stuff. I was doing the business stuff, and we were able to grow beyond just one store, which is what most people ever have in those type of industries. Mm-hmm. And the other thing I've always been very good at is working out the maximum points of leverage. So what do I need to work on to get me to scale and get me to distribute my product as quick as possible? So I've always understood that key concept of leverage really, really well. And generally that means not doing the work, right? So I think that pretty much explains how I've been able to stay at a strategic helicopter level and then choose some people that obviously can run the businesses. And there's another key little point here, which is all about accepting the fact that when you let go to grow, that if you hire a person, they may only do 80% of what you are capable of doing. But as soon as you hire two people at 80%, you're now sitting at 160%. And it doesn't matter how hard I ever work, I can never do 160% of my personal capability. So I think that explains it pretty nicely.
No, it is actually brilliant. Again, and it's funny because you're working smarter and less, and yet most people can't let go.
Yeah.
It's like it's their baby, they got to control it, even though they might logically know that it's the right thing to do.
Well, I still control it, right? And I'm still responsible for it. But right. I'm riding my bike for half a day training for Ironman too. So, this is what I love about business. Business is so creative and it gives you that opportunity to obviously make more money. You get your time back. Time is just the thing that people really, really sell and don't value as clearly as much as what they should. It's just way more fun being the business owner. And you get to spend more time with your friends and family, do all those things that you like. Life is not that difficult, really. If you just design a life that lets you do the things that you like to do more and more often, you should be a happy person. And so it's not complicated. And business gives you that opportunity. When you get a business to the point where it's running without you or you not doing a full week work on it, you can go and do all that cool stuff that you want to do, whether it be holidays around the world or, sailing your yacht, or for me, it's doing my Ironman races around the world. So
would you say that you help people by getting the right people involved in your businesses so you win and they win?
Totally. I'm also accepting of the fact that not everybody is going to be an entrepreneur. Not everybody wants to take the risk that I'm prepared to take. And there are the Steve Ballmers of the world who supported Bill Gates beautifully and made $40 billion. So, he knew what his spot in life was to be the number two guy. But he still did just fine out of it. And yet Bill Gates got, up till recently, got all the fame and glory. It's all about choosing a team and putting people in the right seat on the bus so that the bus still drives forward. And, I have trained some people that I've mentored in my companies to then leave my businesses and go out and start their own companies as well. So not everybody stays with me for life. I'm so happy if they go off and start their own company. It's what I want for them because I know they'll be better off long term. But
well, what they say, going back to sports, they say about how you determine who the most successful coaches are and what is based on the legacy they create by their assistant coaches going out and being great coaches.
Yeah, exactly.
It's amazing how that works. what's also interesting I wanted to ask you is, a lot of companies are so vested in, we get our funding, and they finally get it and they celebrate, and then they don't necessarily know how to scale it, or they're so excited about almost like winning the championship was getting the funding that they don't know how to take it to the next level. How do you handle that?
Okay, so it's pretty easy down in New Zealand, Australia, because there is no funding. There is no money. So we have to get to a position of profit ASAP. We have to get to break even as quick as possible, because really there is very little money in terms of investment capital compared to the US down under. It's very difficult to raise venture capital. Every business I've had to bootstrap myself, funded it myself. That first company that we, the first optometry practice we bought, we got 100% debt at 26 years old. And it was only because it was a medical type business that the banks were happy to lend 100% on that. but you know, going forward, I've now got funding, but my balance sheet looks entirely different, and I take investors on board. So, you know, it's a real challenge, this whole funding thing. The analogy I like to think about is having a baby. This whole, it's a bit of a fantasy having a startup these days, and we call it with TechCrunch. You know, they always put up all of the amazing stories about some 19-year-old kid that sells his business for $50 million, or a 25-year-old that sells it for $500 million, or a 23-year-old that sells WhatsApp for $18 billion. And we actually end up calling it TechCrunch porn, because it's real, but it's not really real. You know, it is only happening on such a tiny, tiny percentage of businesses. And in the real world that I sort of live in, and 99% of us live in, business is tough. And raising money is not easy. And getting to break even is not easy. And making a good profit is not easy. And so where we come from, your business valuation is based on your profit. It's a multiple of profit. You know, we don't have this wonderful sort of bubble that is generally in America, where you know people can get millions and millions of dollars just for a business that hasn't even got any customers yet. So
it's interesting what you say, though, and it's totally true. Even though there might be more money here, I remember Peter Thiel, who was the first investor really in Facebook, and then he had PayPal. You know, he said these are phenomena. You know, Facebook. These are, you know, and it's just like you get an actor, and people say, well, he made it overnight or whatever. They're far and few between. So I think you're right on the money that you – goes back to what you said before. You've got to keep going to make it happen. And but, you know, we're into the – you know, we want fast gratification, like fast food at McDonald's all the time, right?
Sure.
And but you got to still work for it. It's interesting stuff, and I wanted to ask you, boards – we talked a little bit about this before – people have different views on how to use a board, even to have a board, especially entrepreneurial. I was talking to a CEO of a company in Philippines and U.S. recently, and they don't have a board yet, and they're growing. And he said, yeah, I probably should have one, but I really don't want – you didn't want to have to interact with anybody, really, at that point. What's your thoughts on boards for young, growing companies?
Cool. Well, I definitely agree 100% in having an advisory board. So mm-hmm. – Not necessarily, you know, there's a difference between having just an advisory board, a group of mentors, which I have used a lot in my career. Then there's also having investors on board that then become part of the board, and choosing those people is important. Like in my – I have a large SMS marketing company that is in US, New Zealand and Australia. And we've got an ex-CEO of a big telco. Now, she is very well connected with all the other CEOs of the other telcos, which is really important for that business. So it's a strategic relationship as well as an investment. So, but I really like to keep my boards pretty small, to be honest. Around that 4-5 people is plenty. I think over that you get, you know, becomes bureaucratic. You don't make decisions as quickly. And it becomes, even just arranging a meeting, becomes a nightmare because everybody's busy. So I like to keep my boards pretty small is the way I do it. And of course, there has to be a good dynamic there, because, you know, you want everyone on the same page, and preferably they only get a seat on the board if they've put up money, so that they're invested and not just sitting there for a director's fee. So that's my view on boards pretty much.
No, I think it's the right way to go. I'm going to complete part one, and we're going to head into part two right now. So hang on, folks.